Well, most of you know Summer because she works with us for CLE. So Paula told you we had the privilege of working with her these past 2 years. She's doing evaluation with us. So we wrangled her in to come speak at this program. We didn't have to really wrangle her. She was more than willing. She's always, as Paula said, such a pleasure to work with. She comes with a lot of energy. So we appreciate that because our work sometimes, it's difficult. But Summer is always a smile on her face. Pleasure to work with. So I'm going to just read a little something and introduce her. I already gave her her lei because we had to work that out. So Summer is the daughter of Hadessa Puahi Maunakea and James Kuleana Kila Maunakea Jr. Summer Puanani Maunakea has roots in Waipahu, Oahu, and Hilo and Puna, Hawaii. Summer works as an educational specialist at Kapapalo'i o Kanewai within the Hawai'inuiakea School of Hawaiian Knowledge at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, like Paula said. Currently, she's pursuing a PhD in education, and her research seeks to advocate for Mālama ʻAina practitioner educators and awaken the critical need for all people of Hawaii to reconnect to and act upon their kuleana to ʻAina through Huli Kalima Ilalo, turning one's hand down into the land, to be healed, nourished, and led into a thriving future for OEV. So it's my pleasure to introduce you to Summer, and most of you know her.
Aloha mai kako, everybody. Aloha. So nice to be here. We're just here last week for our CLE ʻOhana series, and it is such a pleasure, and I'm so grateful to be able to come out here and work with ʻOhana series, Christy and the Kapua crew. But more so, I feel really grateful for all the aloha that I've got from all of you. And I see all of our ʻOhanas as my aunties and my uncles, and then all of the keiki as my peers, some of them, and also I see myself as a role model for the young ones. So it's a lot of kuleana, but really grateful. So I just wanted to say mahalo for coming, just to start, say mahalo. Thank you. Again, I would like to just say thank you to my makua, to my parents, James Kuleana Kila Maunakea Jr. and Hadessa Puahi Maunakea. My parents have been to every one of my field trips since preschool. my graduations, my cheerleading nationals trips to Florida, they were at every one, and they filled those white coolers with mailele, spam, manapua, all the things we love. They've just always been so supportive. Just on the way over here, my dad was driving in traffic, and my mom was helping me cut and fold all of the tea bags because we're gonna do a la'au lapa'au tea today. And that's just normal for them. They're at my first parent-teacher conference when I was actually a teacher. they came to the orientation at Kamehameha Summer School. I was so nervous, and my mom has a lot of spunk and a lot of fire, so I thought, oh, if anything happens, at least my mom's gonna back me up. So just again, mahalo to my parents, and then my Maunakea ʻOhana, Auntie Alexis and Auntie Ruby for coming out here. Just my Nānākuli ʻOhana coming to back me up too. So thank you very much. I feel, like I said, very blessed and honored, very grateful all the time. So I just wanted to introduce my presentation. I called it Towards Living Mālama ʻAina, and I wanted to emphasize that towards because it's a process that I'm going through, trying to be aware of myself, my actions as a Hawaiian, my actions as a daughter, my actions as a teacher, as a student. And I found that Mālama ʻAina, and I'll go more into it, but I found that it's a principle in our culture, the culture of our land of Hawaii, but it's a principle to be practiced as well. So I called it Towards Living Mālama ʻAina. And my personal journey of acting upon my kuleana, or my purpose, my responsibility, through my family, through education, and through well-being. So just to introduce my presentation, I'm gonna do a quick journey through my education and the key lessons learned. Then I'm gonna go into Mālama ʻAina, what I arrived at what Mālama ʻAina means, and how I use it as a lens or as a vehicle through my education, my work, and into scholarship. And then, because I found out that I was gonna be the only speaker tonight, and I said, I wouldn't wanna listen to myself talk for an hour and a half or 2 hours. I prayed a lot, and I asked the kua, can you please help me out and maybe give me an idea or something that I can do as an action of gratitude, of course, but something that I can share and teach from what I've learned throughout the years. So we're gonna do that's the Mālama ʻAina and wellness piece, the well-being piece, a uhaloa and ʻolana tea. And it'll be hands-on, since we advocate for hands-on learning and cultural learning here. So it'll be a hands-on activity, a tea that we're going to pule over, we're gonna pray over it, and you can even start thinking of maybe somebody in your ohana or yourself that you would like this tea to be for. And then we'll have questions, and if you wanna share any of your mana'o at the end. All right, so I always start with what I just did. Ohana is everything. There's a olalo no eau I mai ka I ke kalo I ka oha, and that's saying that the goodness or the fruit of the kalo itself, the plant, is shown through its shoots, the oha. I didn't put the English there because I'm not positive how it's translated, but that's how I understand it. And so you can tell how good the plant is by the keiki. When I learned that olalo no eau and I took it to heart, I thought, wow, I have a really big responsibility. The way I conduct myself as a student and as a daughter and everything, just as a Hawaiian, it really reflects my family. And my actions, people will say that, and see that, and then they'll say, oh, she must come from a good family, or, oh, I don't even want to know where she comes from, what kind of family she comes from. And so that's another guiding principle in my life, to make sure that I'm trying my best all the time, and I have a lot of aloha so that it'll be reflected on my parents and my kupuna and my lines, my genealogy, and everybody that has come before me. So I love these old pictures. And like I said, my parents are the best. I called my mom at about 8 o'clock this morning going, Mom, I need all these pictures for my PowerPoint. So all day she was looking through the albums, and I get home and all the albums is on the bed. And she picked out all these pictures. So this is a picture. This is my mom and her parents, Abraham Na'o, and then her mom. And that's a beautiful picture. But that's my mom right there. And then my dad is right here. Yeah. This is my dad. He's the oldest of 9 children. This is my grandpa, James Kulanakila Maunakea Sr., and then my grandma, Asuncion Aranda. And they had 9 kids. And I call this time in my dad's life his prime. Such a stud. So that's my parents and their families, where I've come from. This is all of my cousins and my aunties and uncles on my dad's side. The Maunakeas, we all have this signature forehead, which I'm really proud of. So these are all my cousins. These are all my cousins on my mom's side. My auntie Tweety just passed a couple of weeks or a month ago. And this was at her funeral, her celebration. So these are all my cousins on that side. And then down here, this is our family. This is my my two brothers, Kolu and Tyler. And then Kolu's wife, Jen. And then their two babies, my nephews, Koa and Jacob. This is my Uncle Lloyd. Uncle Lloyd is my dad's youngest son, but he's always been a part of, youngest brother, always been a part of our immediate ohana. And then this is my boyfriend, Mahi'ai Dochin from Waimea, Hawaii. So family is everything. So moving into my journey through education and lessons learned. I've always believed that family was my first teacher. And the lesson that I learned was aloha, unconditional love. Sometimes my brothers were a little, mean. They're the reason why I hate video games, because there was only two controllers in my day. So I was always the one that didn't get to play. But truly, the lesson that I learned from my first teachers, my family, is aloha. Then I went to Alphabet Land Preschool in Waipahu. And the lesson I learned was, or the thing I gained the most, was my love for learning. My mom was my preschool teacher as well that first year. She always fed me extra cookies during nap time. My next lesson through education, it was not through school, but it was through hoiva'a or canoe paddling. Kamehameha Canoe Club. It started when I was eight. This is when I was eight. And then this was just last year at a race. Did the Molokai and with Huliko'a for my first time. So paddling canoe has always been in my family and a big lesson for me because it taught me a lot about laulima, working together, community, leadership, as I learned how to steer when I was really young, and it was scary, but I needed to know how to keep that boat straight, and ocean awareness, as well as Kuleana or responsibility, because every seat has a responsibility. My next lesson learned, not really academics, but cheerleading at Kamehameha schools. I learned a lot about high expectations and what high expectation does for a young person. My cheerleading coach, Dolly Wong, at seventh grade said, you're gonna lead us to our first national championship. And I didn't know what that was, but I stuck with it. And it taught me a lot about what having high expectations can do. And then it taught me a lot about self-belief and believing that I have everything within me to succeed. Taught me a lot about work ethic, dedication, repetition, success. But most of all, it taught me about humility. Whenever they would call, say if we won first, usually when another team hears that somebody else is second, everybody celebrates big time because you know you're first. But we were always taught you hold it in, you give the other team the respect, and then you celebrate when it's your time. So ha'a ha'a or humility. And lastly, kulia'i kanu'u, a very popular olelo no'eo to strive for the summit in, or to the top in everything that I do. So that was when we were national championships. It's about more than 10 years later, but I still go back to that, two-time national champions. And everybody laughs because they think I'm living in the past. But yeah, that was my next lesson. Around my senior year of high school, I started going to church. I started going to Young Life. And eventually, I entered into a Christian college in California, Azusa Pacific University. There, I learned so much. I went on all these missions trips, Christian Surf Cafe in Tenerife, Spain, which is off the coast of Africa. I learned a lot about the power of prayer. Our kupuna were all very spiritual, and I know because I feel it within me. But to understand the power of prayer for healing, for encouragement, for guidance, it was something that I really started to understand during this time in my life. Also, spiritual gifts. Different people from all over the world would pull me aside and say, you have a gift in this, and you're going to be able to do this in the future. And I started believing in those things and that high expectation, that unconditional love. And I claimed it. I said, I'm going to use all of my goodness for the glory of God, but also to show everybody how we need to treat each other. So that's what I learned in college. It was a very expensive lesson that I'm still paying student loans for, and so are my parents paying parent loans for. But I got a bachelor's in liberal arts, liberal studies with an emphasis in education. My next lesson learned after I graduated, I moved to Aotearoa or New Zealand for a year to surf. And just to celebrate that I went to school for about, what would that be, 20 years almost? That I went to school for that long, I decided I'm gonna take a year-long surf trip and I'm gonna work anywhere I can. And my parents always, I was grateful, they always gave me everything that I needed, but they taught me, if you want anything, you need to work for it. You need to save money. So I would work 3 jobs and just save money so I could travel, so I could pay off all my student loans for the year and then disappear for a year and go and travel. So in Aotearoa, I learned la'ala'o, or enjoying life and enjoying things like surfing and being out in the elements. The next year I moved to Australia and I was a kindergarten teacher. At that time I found that I had a gift in teaching. I loved them. I loved teaching about growing plants. But I learned a critical lesson, and it was a question I had. Why didn't I learn any of this stuff in school? We were composting our food for 4 and 5 year old students. We were growing vegetables organically. In the play yard, they had beds of vegetables. And I didn't know what to do. I said, somebody's gonna have to teach me how to do this so I can teach these kids. So I was taught how to grow organic vegetables and fruits by 5-year-olds. But it brought up a lot of questions. You know, I thought, why did a lot of my ancestors, my uncles and my aunties, why do they all have diabetes, heart disease? My mom's, you know, some of her brothers passed away in their 40s, and they're all, you know, they're all Hawaiian blooded. And so I thought, there's something wrong here. There's something wrong that I didn't grow up learning about my food. I didn't grow up learning about how to grow healthy food. And there's something wrong that the health disparities in my ohana and our community is prevalent. So I moved home with a purpose. I moved home with a purpose to impact my ohana's well-being, but also to get a master's degree in education. So I went for it and I got all of the weeds in the backyard, mulched everything. For about a month, I would move these cement pavers to make these garden beds and everything. I started planting a lot of vegetables, a lot of kalo that I got from the farmer's market. But more importantly, I started doing that with my nephews. 8 koa is 8, Jacob is 3. And that was really special because I was seeing if I could live the things that I believed in. Planting a lot of foods, little banana tree back there, pulling our own lettuces and cucumbers and making green juices because they're packed with nutrients. And my nephew's trying these green juices. And then my dad going, no way. And my brother's like not even giving me the time of day. But they liked it. They liked the taste of these vegetables and fruits and everything. I said, oh, this is real. This is something to keep doing. And so I ended up being in Nanai Kopono Elementary School for my teaching. And I was so grateful because I had Miss Paishan. At the time, it was her last year at Nanai Kopono. So I got the best veteran teacher to mentor me into teaching. The best. Every time anybody heard, ask who's your mentor teacher, I said, Miss Paishan. And they said, you're really lucky. And Miss Paishan, she let me do my crazy ideas of applying for a grant, for a bucket garden grant. And this woman coming in, bringing these 5-gallon buckets from restaurants that have been recycled. And all the kids got to paint their own bucket. She drilled the holes on the bottom. I used my dad's truck. I filled it with soil, brought it over to Nanai Kopono. And we filled these buckets with soil. And the kids, the first graders, got to plant anything they wanted to plant. I went and I bought seeds. I brought huli and everything. And they loved it. And Ms. Paishan let me experiment to see if I could teach the standards and everything using growing kalo and bucket gardening. And it was really successful, and the students had a lot of fun. And that's what I did my master's thesis on, bucket gardening in first grade at Nanai Kopono. It was another tool in my tool belt that said, this is good, this works, this is making a difference. But the lesson learned from Ms. Paishan about teaching is to teach students to have responsibility for themselves, their responsibility for their learning, as a teacher to have unconditional love for them, and to celebrate. Once I walked into class every day, Ms. Paishan was with the kids. Yay! She had treasure chests, all these things so that students would be determined to learn, and they knew that they were loved. And I learned that through watching Ms. Paishan teach, and she was the best model to have. So at the end of it, I didn't know if I was going to stay with Nanai Kopono or continue on with my PhD and work at the lo'i where I work. Ms. Paishan said to pray about it, to ask Jesus to lead you, and I did, and I decided to stay at the university and pursue my PhD. At that time, I got a job working at Kapapa Lo'i o Kane Wai at UH Manoa. It's a 1-acre lo'i, ancient lo'i in the middle of Honolulu. It's pretty cool. And also at Kapapa Lo'i o Punalu'u, which is on Kamehameha School's land. And it was here I learned makahana ka'ike, to learn or to gain knowledge by doing. There's no book, no textbook that tells you how to grow kalo. If there is, it's specific to a place, a time, and an environment. So you learn by doing. I learned how to prepare food in the imu from a pig, from killing the pig and then putting it in the imu. Learned everything about food prep, kulolo, haupia, lomi salmon, lomi opai, all those things. And there's these three principles at Kapapa Lo'i o Kane Wai: Mālama ʻĀina, laulima, and pu'u honua. Now, they were left by Uncle Harry Kunihi Mitchell of Keanae Maui. He taught the students in the 1980s that found this existing lo'i how to farm kalo, how to build hale. And they reestablished this place so that students like ourselves could come to have a safe place, a pu'u honua, laulima, to work together, and mālama ʻĀina, love, care, and protection for our place. I also learned that knowledge is found in the land and knowledge is found in the continuity of practice, which is a lot different than how I was learning before, knowledge being found in a book and a test and all of that. And so that this picture right here, the Owai is a ditch, and the Owai brings fresh water from the existing stream of Mānoa, and it brings it through the land, and it feeds all the kalo, and then it exits out, eventually down to the Aloai Canal, which wasn't always there. But it's a system of land management, and it's a system of food cultivation that is ancient, but modern in its practice as well. We eat the kalo, we feed the kalo to our community. I think I brought a lot of kalo huli over here that you're probably growing the kalo that grew at my house, that grew at Kanewai before. So I learned that at Kapapalo'i o Kanewai and Kapapalo'i o Punalu'u. There's also Uncle Eric Enos' lo'i at Ka'ala Farms. I haven't visited there, but it's so close to over here, and I can't wait to go and spend time with him up there. So then I entered into this practice of Mālama ʻĀina. I got these definitions from the Pukui and Albert Dictionary. You can see Mālama, we always think Mālama is care, but Mālama is all of these things. It's protection, maintaining things, to observe, to conduct a service, to care for. And ʻĀina is not only land, but I learned ʻĀina as all that feeds and provides for us. So I arrived upon my understanding of Mālama ʻĀina, to care for, protect, and ensure the continuity of all that feeds and sustains land, water, plants, animals, ocean, and all contained therein. So it's this whole thing. And I thought that that's what we try and do at work, that's what we strive for. That's what I strive for with my family. But this idea of Mālama ʻĀina, this practice is an ancient one, and it goes all the way back to our genealogies, beyond Haloa, beyond all of that. And it starts with this interdependence and relationship that we have with our place and the people. From a genealogy that starts from elements that come together and create our islands, that come together and create our food, and then eventually kanaka and people. So finding myself at the bottom of that genealogy of the kanaka side of it, the person, and having everybody above, all the things above me being plants, land, and elements. I think as the youngest, what is my responsibility? Well, my responsibility is to care for all of the things that are older than me. And all the things that are older than me, my parents, my brothers, the land, plants, they're going to provide for me. And it's that reciprocal relationship that I'm stuck in the middle of, that I keep continuing to learn about myself. So using Mālama ʻĀina as a lens, I think of glasses. If I were to put Mālama ʻĀina on as glasses, how would I see the world? How would I see my responsibility to my family, my responsibility in work, in scholarship, in teaching? So I got the opportunity 2 years ago when Christy them called and asked that I come on board to do research and evaluation. I took one class of evaluation for my PhD, and I didn't know really how to do it. And I was so nervous when I met with them the first day. But I said, high expectation, it's that lesson I learned a long time ago. These, you know, the community is having a high expectation for me. Am I gonna believe in myself that I have everything within to do it? Or I'm gonna say, no, I can't. So I said, sure. I always say, yeah, why not? And I ended up coming on board. And I've learned a lot, but most of all, I've found my voice and a lot of my confidence in front of groups, and then confidence in my studies as well, that I'm prepared enough to take on these tasks. It's a picture of Uncle Kona and Kate. I found out that they're ohana just a little while ago. Such a joy to hang out with Uncle Kona and his daughter Kate. So I put that picture up. Also work. So I, We just planted kalo at my house. This was about a year ago. And this is in Waipahu. And everybody says, what do you do to your soil or your kalo? And I say, it's a lot of aloha. And it's a lot of my dad and my mom going outside and pulling weeds when I'm not home. So this is our mala'ai, or our garden. And then also, Mālama ʻĀina through scholarship. And that's the education piece, the PhD piece. I was asked to write for a publication just a year ago, and I slaved over it. It was really hard for a year. I thought, I don't know how to do this. I'm not a great writer. But instead, I interviewed two Hawaiian scholars, Daviana McGregor and Jonathan Osorio, and talked to them about their beliefs in research and their career. And in the process of trying to make sense of all of the wealth they were sharing for me, I was stressed, I was really stressed. And one day I was working in the Owai with a group of elementary school students, and it came to me that all the answers are already there. That framework that was left, Mālama ʻĀina, Laulima, Pu'u Honua, could be a way to view research as well, and how to understand that. So, with their interviews, I came up with a framework to do research in Hawaiian communities. Community is in the center, so when I do evaluation work, I go by this because it's what I really believe, it's what I found, that everything I do in school, research, scholarship, writing, must go to the protection and advocacy for ʻAina, for all that feeds and sustains us. It must be relevant and initiated by the community. And the kuleana of the researcher is recognized by the community. And this is a big deal because in the past, people have just come in, taken all the information they needed to know, and they publish it. They elevate to a status of a professor or doctor or whatever. And then all of that knowledge and that research goes on the shelf somewhere. And the community never reads it, and their descendants are never empowered by it. Next, Laulima, the role of the collective. And so that's all of our responsibilities in producing scholarship. So that's the interviews that we do, the written responses. Everybody's voice is important when engaging in academics and scholarship. And then weaving together all of the sources to create a really rich story that benefits community. So protecting the intellectual rights of all the sources. Kumujan taught me that it's never okay to use somebody else's voice as your own. Remaining accountable to the community, and also presenting findings that are beneficial only. So it's really exciting because this is going to be published, and then I can cite myself for my dissertation. The last little bubble here, I'm just going to go through this real fast because I'd love to get to our activity. But I'm just going to give a brief overview of my dissertation research, my PhD. The purpose of it is to answer this question right here. How do all people of Hawaii reconnect to and act upon their kuleana to ʻAina? And because I'm in education, it's through education. So first I'm looking at global and local education, ecological issues. And so that's a big phrase. But it's mainly looking at policy. It's looking at our DOE policy. Did you know that in the strategic plan it says connection to family, community, and ʻAina is a priority? So when I look in the school system, I see the priority is test taking and two subjects, English and math. And so it's looking at the policies that are already in place and saying, how are these values being pursued in practice in our schools? And then also looking at our ecological issues. And we know we're in big trouble, right, with global warming and biodiversity and everything. So it's looking at all of those issues as the platform for my research, for my studies. Then I'm looking at primary source documentation of the interdependence, this Mālama ʻĀina, the connection of kanaka, of people, not only Hawaiians now, because we all live here and not all of us have ancestry here, but we all have a responsibility to this place. So looking at the modern application to this historical documentation of interdependence of kanaka and ʻAina. A couple of really neat things I found, a very treasured kupuna in this community, and one of our kupuna in our families, kupuna Catherine Maunakea. I was listening to one of her tapes, her Kaleo Hawaii tapes, when they audio recorded all in Hawaiian. And she brought her entire class to this interview. And everybody had a responsibility in this piece. And this one child got up and said, Hua olalo kahiku, ne huli kalima iluna pololi koopu, ne huli kalima ilalo piha koopu. So when your hands are turned up, you're hungry. When your hands are turned down, you're full. And it's so critical that we do this in our families and our schools, working in the land, working, not only writing, not only reading, but working so that we may all be nourished and full. Moving on to this methodology piece, or the process of research, which I covered before with that framework. But looking at research through ike kupuna, or ancestral knowledge, what we are all very rich in. The next piece is nana ike kumu. So this means to look to the source. And a lot of the sources are our kumu, or our teachers. The source for Mālama ʻAina would be, I find that they're the practitioner educators. So those are your Uncle Eric Enos's, and our fishermen, and the people that have been practicing these sustainable practices on the land for ages. But they also are educators, so they have their hands on the youngest children that come to their farm. So they're that bridge. They're the bridge from the mo'olelo and the stories, the practices of old, and they're applying it to today. So it's looking to those sources as to how we can honor Kuleana to ʻAina. So that's my dissertation in a nutshell that I'm not really there yet, but I'm at the proposal phase, so another year and a half and I should be done. In the meantime, I'm working over here and I'm always around, but that's that piece that I wanted to share about what I do in school and why I have headaches all the time from studies and why I complain to my friends all the time about, oh, I don't know what I'm doing kind of thing. But I know it's important that I strengthen all of these aspects, the academic side, the being close with my family side, the being near to the ʻAina and growing my own food side. I know that it's very holistic, and when we engage in Mālama ʻAina and these practices, we're being healed and we're relearning these things that are already within us. Auntie Pua Kanahele, I just went to a workshop with her in Hilo, and she talks about your na'au as DNA, and that sometimes when you're doing practices or you're planting something, or you think, oh, I've done this before, or if you pound kalo, oh, I've done this before. She says that's your na'au, that's your DNA, reminding you who you are, where you're from, and what your purpose is. And so my final lesson learned, and it's a lesson I'm still learning, is to follow my na'au. And I think if we all do that, we would be really happy people, but really well in our communities as well. So that was my research. And then the fun part, Mālama ʻAina and well-being. So like I said, I didn't know I had to do this the whole presentation, but I pule'd, I prayed, and this beautiful person came to my rescue. This is Lena Ala Bright. She is a La'o Lapa'o, so a Hawaiian healing medicine practitioner and a Lomi Lomi practitioner as well. And she just came on Thursday, it was her birthday. She came for the ʻOhana series. She wanted to meet everybody and listen to the speaker. But I was talking to her, I said, you know, I always plant kalo with everybody and I love it. But the chickens tore up all of my huli at home and now I don't have any kalo to plant and I want to try something new. And so we've made tea before at her house. And she said, well, I had to do this activity with students, sixth grade students on Lana'i, and also with the Queen Liliʻuokalani Children's Center in Waimanalo. And it came through prayer. This activity came through prayer for her too. And so she shared it with me and I thought I would love to share this with our ʻOhana as well. So we're gonna make ʻOlena and ʻUhaloa tea. I just started using ʻOlena a lot. We all know ʻOlena, right? We all know about turmeric. We all eat curry. I've been eating curry stew since I was little. I love it. And so ʻOlena is that yellow, that turmeric, yeah, that piece. ʻOlena, I'm going to read it from what Lena Ala shared with me. Strengthens our immune system. It's anti-inflammatory, anti-cancer. For flu and cold season, it's a good thing to eat, to make as a tea as well. And it's traditionally used for sinus and respiratory system. ʻUhaloa, I've used ʻUhaloa before. And ʻUhaloa is really good if you have sore throat and also for your immune system. And then I just learned this from another La'o Lapa'o practitioner. ʻUhaloa is good for your skin, to preserve skin. And so they do facials and stuff with ʻUhaloa. So the combination together is good for the flu, cold, building immunity. So we're gonna make a tea today. We're gonna make our own tea bags so that you can take it home for your families as well, or for yourself. So the steps, Lena Albright is also a lecturer at WCC, at Windward Community College as well. The first step that I've learned for La'o Lapa'o is prayer. So everybody just start maybe thinking about somebody that you would like to make this healing tea for. And then we'll just start with a pule, a short prayer. Then I'm gonna do the demonstration. And then everybody's gonna have a chance to make a tea bag. It's good because 40 is the magic number, yeah? 40 is that really good number. Last time I brought 40 huli to plant and it was perfect amount. So I brought 40 tea bags for everybody to make. Now I only have 25 of those needles. They're thick needles, so if we can share those, that would be good. Okay, so first we're going to pule. I'm gonna do the demonstration and then everybody can make the tea bags as well. Okay, so ready? E pule kako. E ke akua, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us together today. Thank you for all the food that nourished our bodies, for the hands that prepared it at Ma'o Farms. Thank you for this structure. Thank you for Kamehameha Schools. You're so great and you always provide for us everything we need. Thank you for the la'au, for the ʻUhaloa, and for the ʻOlena that was grown at Kapapalo'i o Kanewai. And we thank you for the knowledge that has been passed down to us from our kupuna and through teachers. Thank you that we have the capacity to keep these things alive and to heal our families as well. So I ask that you come with us, be in our plants, be in our minds, in our hearts. Give us the ability to make these things to help heal our families. We thank you for everything. If we can just think of a person right now that we would like in our families that we would like to make the tea for and say a quick prayer for them. We ask you to be with us during this process and send your healing powers. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Yay, I'm so excited. Okay, so who's made a tea before? Anybody made la'au tea before? This is gonna be a great experience for all of us then. So I forgot to mention that the olena, if you can see right here, this is the olena, and we just planted olena. Yeah, we just planted it at Ma'o Farms, if you're with the Ohana series, a couple of months ago. My olena's doing great. I don't know about yours. I didn't replant it yet, but I don't know how this one is still going. Our olena, what will happen is it'll grow, it's like kalo, and then it'll kind of die back. And it'll actually die down and you can't see the plant anymore. It's about a 9-month process, and just so happened that it was olena season at this time where it's ready to harvest. So I, when was that? Yesterday. Yeah, yesterday I just pulled out two of these little guys right here. I pulled them out. I was praying for you guys while I was doing it too, so it'll be very healing. And then I washed it, soaked it in grape seed extract. I don't know if you've heard about that grape seed. It kills all the little critters, Linala was explaining to me. Like any kind of little bugs on it, it'll kill it. And it's natural. So soaked that for a couple of, maybe an hour I soaked it. And then the same with the uhaloa. This grows where I work too, so I harvested all of this for us. A couple of things you need. So one piece of the cloth, so this is muslin. We just got it yesterday from Fabric Mart. It's unbleached, so it's okay. Muslin, a cotton twine string, and then I use this needle. It's the thickest one I could find, but it's still, you can still sew it in. So what we'll do, we can start the water. This is the, this is a really neat induction cooktop. My parents got me one for Christmas too. It's not being spoiled. I always heard, you're so spoiled. I said, spoiled is when you're not grateful. Blessed? No, spoiled is when you're not grateful. Blessed is when you are. Okay, so water is gonna boil. And then once it starts boiling, we'll turn it off, because we're just gonna steep the tea. For the tea bag, you're gonna come and get, so what I did, it's just a 15 by 15 square, cut it, and then we folded it, and then we cut the top so that it was just a circle. I didn't bring a pattern, or we don't really have a pattern. We just did it in the car on the way here, but that one, I made a mistake on that one. I was going round, so it looks like it's scalloped edge, but then it'll come out to like a circle or a rounded square. So then, what you're gonna do is you're gonna get one muslin cloth. I measured the string to about one arm's length, yeah. and then I attached it to the needle. It's not sharp or anything. So the needles are in there too. Okay. So I brought some towels. I think the tables are clean, but if you can lay the paper towel on your table so that it can, this can lay on top. All right, so what you're gonna do, where you see the creases, you're gonna go about 1 inch below the crease. So what you're just doing is making a quick in and out stitch like that. Real easy. Okay. So you're just gonna go around. Maybe if, does somebody wanna come up and help stitch this through? We can get started on that if anybody wants to come up and Sewing with Summer. I got a funny story about sewing. So at Kamehameha schools, our uniforms were really long. I hated it. I said, Mom, can you hem this? It's so long. She said, if you want a short dress, you're gonna have to learn how to sew it yourself. So that's how I learned how to sew, making a little dress. Pauahi would be proud, yeah?
Shorter.
Hey. This is recorded. Oh. I'm in trouble.
Sorry.
Okay, so while my mom is threading, I'm just gonna show everybody. So last night Mahi'ai wasn't feeling good. My boyfriend wasn't feeling good. So I said, perfect, I'm gonna practice. I made the tea. So this is the ʻOhana and the ʻUhaloas inside. Very important at the end, after you use your tea, you have to give your la'o back to the ʻAina, back to the place. That's the most important. Yeah, so you'll just take it out and put it somewhere special in your yard. I'll take this back to Kanewai. Because this was grown at Kanewai, so I'll go and I'll give it back. And I'll say mahalo, you know, for giving your life so that we could help heal our families and everything. So, yeah. But so you'll see that we're just making a little basket, like a tea bag. So after you have it in that nice little bag, the dosing I learned is, this is for one person, for yourself. This is the dose. Since you're gonna make it for your family, and it just depends how much ʻUhaloa we have. So if you just do this for now, what I did, cause I made about 6 cups of tea, I did a whole handful like that, this much. Then we're not going to, you only want to prepare the ʻOhana when it's time to make the tea, because you don't want the koko, Linalek calls it the koko, you don't want it to come out yet. But since we're going to make this now, I can show. This is my pohaku, and I made it a long time ago. I thought I was making it to Kuikalo or to Paumpoi, but my kane Mahi'ai, he's real good at it, so I figure I don't need to do it. So now it's my la'o lapa'o pohaku. And then you prepare this just like you would prepare ginger. And so you can use a mortar and a pestle, or you can use a pohaku. And this is just a cutting board, so just. Yeah. You can use the this is the kae. This is what we use to break up the kalo at first. So this. And so look at the color. Yeah. If anybody wants to come up and crush this ʻOhana, you can come.
Sure is coming.
Oh, here, yeah, auntie. No, this is ʻOhana. It's in the family. Yep, this is the plant.
You know, if you tell me crush, I just bang.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. And so, oh, also I forgot to show. This is the blossom too. It grows like this. This picture right here. And I have half a bag, so if everybody can just take a spoonful like this, then that'll be the dosing for this tea. Yeah, so we can do this much of the, we have enough to do this much ʻUhaloa, and then the spoonful of the blossom. Yeah. How are you doing, Mom? Okay. So this, the ʻUhaloa is, it grows as a weed by our lo'i. And we used to just blast with the weed whackers when we work. So we used to just blast it all down, and then, I don't know, somebody came in, one of our limahana came to work with us. He's like, oh, this is ʻUhaloa. It's like, oh my gosh, hello. You know, learning process for all of us. So it grows as a weed. You might even find it in your yards.
Is that weed?
Uh-huh. Yeah. So it's a weed if it's someplace, I learned, it's a weed if it's someplace that it's not supposed to be. But it's also medicine. Yeah, so this is our medicine.
So
that's
the ʻUhaloa and the stone?
Yeah, this the low, the leaf is dried, and then this is the blossom. Yeah. And you can use both. First time I had ʻUhaloa in Waimea, where Mahi'ai is from, his dad grows it, and then he vacuum seals it and sends it to Oahu. And then, so we have it, it's plentiful by our lo'i, so I'm gonna start picking more too and drying it out. So, how's it? Okay, so. Wow, Mom. Wow. So here it is. Yeah. So then you'll just get your, I'm gonna make this whole thing and then so that we can all try some after. So I'm gonna do a big one in there.
Why is it some is orange and some is yellow?
You know, it's just, actually, the bigger ones were grown at a different place, I think. It's all maturity. So different ones mature at different times as well, like kalo.
So if too. It's orange, it's more mature?
I'm not sure. It's just because it's from a different place. I'm really not sure. Yeah. So. And for dyeing, so we dye a lot of things, plant dyes. Okay, so we'll turn this off. So plant dyes, we use the real bright orange one. And I'm gonna do a kapa class, how to make our own kapa with Dalani. She lives out Makaha side over here. And so we're gonna be learning all of this stuff too.
That's gonna be cool. Are we gonna be invited?
Yeah, you wanna come? I can teach you what I learned. So then I'll just put, I don't wanna use too much or else we're not gonna all have. And then, so when you're ready to use your tea, you can use the, this is for you guys to take home. So everybody's gonna take one home. And then we're gonna pule over our tea after to close. So just put your olena inside. Sorry, I was doing it behind. Yeah. So you close it up like that. Tie it. And then just wrap this around. Yeah, however you want to wrap it around. Now, when I make tea with Lena Ala, she ties it, and then she, when it's steeping in the pot, she just ties this to the thing so it doesn't sink all the way under. So we'll just doing it over here because it's clean. So tie. Yeah. So you're gonna tie it.
You know what's good for you? Dorm bag.
Yeah.
Go to the store, buy tobacco, the bag, the white bag.
Yeah.
Dorm bag, good tea bag.
Because it strains it all. It's
yeah,
thin.
Strains right.
So even for ava, like when we make ava at work, we use muslin or anything you have. Okay, so we're going to make this real potent with olena. Okay? So we'll put this over here. Oh, if they need help, we can put. So put some. I had a little sore throat too last night after I came home, and then we made the tea and I woke up feeling a lot better. So. I think that might be good. If you're going to make your tea tonight, you can take this home and use it. Okay. All right, so after you have yours in, then you're going to, we'll pule together, and then we'll be pao. And then you can put it in a Ziploc bag and take it home. So I'm going to put this in so we can have some at the end of the night. Okay. Yes, questions? Yep. So one of these fingers. Yeah, that'll be a good dosage. But I'm going to make this whole pot, so I put a lot of it in there.
So how often when you're doing that ratio, mm-hmm. how often would you be able to use it? One or two times?
I just used mine once, but I could use it again. Yeah. Could use it. Decaf. So you can come up and get the tea bag and the string, and then share the needle with your friend.